loved gardening ever since I was young. My mother was a gardener, too. She taught me all of her tricks of the trade. Got me just to love the taste of fresh produce. Not even that supermarket fresh, where they cover them with wax or make them look shiny and perfect like they were photoshopped onto the shelves themselves. Yeah. To me, there is nothing more satisfying than plucking something off the plant, fresh, and still smelling of the garden. Running it under some water and taking a big bite out of it. My mother and I tended to the garden a lot. It wasn't to the point of obsession, not like my dad teased us about. We just planted the seeds, pulled the weeds, gave them water and something to give the soil an extra kick when it needed it. We mixed our own fertilizer, a secret recipe my mother had taught me. My dad never liked being outside when we did it, though. He said we always stunk up the whole backyard when we mixed it. Sorry, Dad. Neither of us minded that he didn't care to spend time in the garden. Garden time was strictly a mother-daughter time. Besides, for all his complaining, my dad did always love the stuff we grew. I don't think I've seen a man since him eat so much salad at dinner. It was a happy time. Of course, it's not like that anymore. My dad died in a car accident about 5 years back, and my mother, after a long and hard-fought battle, finally succumbed to lung cancer about 3 years ago. She ate healthier than any person I've ever known. But she did always like a smoke. I grieved, of course, but I moved on. I own my childhood home now, and the garden with it, of course. I have plenty of friends, and some of the crunchy granola type, and some not. As much as I love fruits and veggies, I can never go vegetarian, or even vegan. Like my best friend Sasha started a few years back. I can't help it. I love burgers too much. So, I've got a decent life. A normal job, working in administration alongside my best friend Sasha in the same company. You might wonder why I don't work in a plant nursery or something like that. But, well, it's like my dad always said. Best to keep work and pleasure separate. I love my gardening, and it's a big hobby of mine. But it's just that, a hobby. Well, a productive hobby, anyways. I always grow too much to eat on my own. So I always end up giving a bunch away to my friends. They all love it. They literally eat it all up. Especially my tomatoes. Ever since I was little, my mom joked that I had a red thumb instead of a green one. Whenever I cared for and tended the tomato plants, they always grew big and beautiful and delicious. Every tomato season, each of them flourished and produced a big old bumper crop. I would literally have baskets of the things. Ugh. In peak season, my dining room looked like a farmer's market. That is, if a farmer's market only stocked up on tomatoes. All of my friends looked forward to it each year. When I told them I had some, word would spread fast. And soon, I'd have my phone buzzing, people calling dibs on who would get some first. Believe me, I wasn't upset about this. Like I said, I grew a lot. Way, way too many for just one person to eat before they went bad. So, I was happy to give a lot of them away. My friends loved them, and I was only too happy to share. The only one who ever really got overwhelming about them was Sasha. She loved them more than anyone else. I would make mention of them, and she'd get this look in her eye. She always seemed to know when they should start growing, too. She tracked the growing season of things. I assume it was to keep track of when best the produce would be in her favorite organic and health food stores. But she was always so adamant about tomato season. We would be sitting next to each other at work, and she would listen to me talk, but I noticed she would subtly steer me towards the topic of my garden. And then she would start talking about health food. And how she loved the stuff I grew, and oh hey! Wasn't it almost time for my tomatoes to start growing? It wasn't a lie, and I always said yes. And how her eyes would always light up. She was always offering to help me out around the garden throughout the year, because she was someone who hated taking without exchange and wanted to do something for all the stuff I grew and gave her. She'd been like that all the time I knew her. But she did get oddly fixated on my tomatoes. She'd work around them, care for them, even better than the other plants around the garden. One time I had to pull up a tomato plant because it got infested by bugs. I swear she looked like she was about to cry. And look, I know that it sounds weird that I lost a tomato plant with how much I touted myself about being good at growing them, but hey, I'm just a gardener, not a miracle worker. It happens to the best of us. But if you want to know something weird, I'll tell you later about that day. It was late when she finally left. A basket full of produce from the day's work. And plenty of tomatoes, of course. I didn't stick around to watch her go. I just went inside the house, expecting her to leave through my back gate to where her car was parked on the street. But as I passed by a back window on my way to the kitchen, I glanced out and saw her. She was standing near the side of my house where I kept my garbage cans. And I kid you not, I swear I saw her rifling through the trash and pulling out handfuls of half-grown, insect-riddled tomatoes. She ran off before I could go out and ask her about it, though. Which brings me to the big incident, where I finally realized that Sasha's love for my tomatoes went too far. More than an innocent craving. I was going into my backyard to mix up some compost on a warm summer night. I like doing my mulch when it's warm, courtesy of a tip from my mother. So I headed out with a 5-gallon bucket, half full of the usual materials I use for it, intending to make a beeline for my compost heap. When all of a sudden, I hear rustling from further in the garden. Used to be the occasional occurrence of a rabbit or some other animal uprooting and eating my stuff. I picked up my shovel and stomped over there, intending to take care of whatever was making all the racket. What I did not expect was to find Sasha, knees pressed into the dirt, half covered in mud, and holding a tomato in each hand, with what looked like a third one stuffed in her mouth. In shock, I asked her what the hell she was doing in my backyard, stealing from my tomatoes. I know I give a lot of stuff away, but she was still taking my stuff without permission. And given we'd been best friends for so long, it kind of hurt to think she would be stealing from me. She swallowed hard, and I had almost winced at the sound of it. And the size of the lump that went down her throat. And such a small, strange voice. She said she'd been hungry, but she'd ran out of tomatoes. They filled her stomach so well, and she just had to have some. Well, seeing as she was my best friend and I didn't want to ruin that over some tomatoes, I sighed and lowered my shovel, telling her to just put down the tomatoes she held and that she could come back tomorrow and have some if she helped me out again. Her eyes went oddly blank. She stared at me too long for me to be comfortable. She did stand up, but unsteady, almost wobbly. And then she bolted at me, and in the gleam of the summer moon, I saw her brandishing a small hand rake I used for gardening. She had this weird, crazed look in her eye, and her teeth were bared, stained with the juice and seeds, but otherwise glinting in the moonlight with what had to have been thousands of dollars of her expensive dental and orthodontics work in her perfect teeth. I shattered those teeth when I swung the shovel into her face. Bits of white flew out of her mouth as she was too shocked to even cry out in pain. By the time she was on the ground, I had already had the shovel up over my head and swung it down onto her exposed neck. With a gurgling and sputtering, that was it. I stepped on the hand with my handbrake until she let go, and waited as the life left her shocked, crazed eyes while she bled out profusely on my ground. When I was sure she was finally dead, I grabbed her by the wrists and dragged her to the compost pile. I could hose off the plants later. Besides, the extra moisture from her blood would be good for them in this heat. After dropping her onto the compost heap and grabbing my axe, I went about cutting her into pieces, carefully to do so in a way that would leave her in small pieces no bigger than my palm. I don't think she would have been so keen on my tomatoes if she knew that animals were, in fact, harmed in their growth. As she proclaimed her vegan lifestyle was meant to be about. All of the dismembered raccoons and rabbits and squirrels and the like most definitely were killed to make them when I mixed them into the mulch. I finished up quickly and set about mixing Sasha into the mulch. There would be leftovers, but I could hide the rest under the compost until then. Waste not, want not, right? It's a funny thing. I've tried this method on other plants before, but the only ones it seems that this method of fertilizing gives so much more flavor are the tomatoes. As I've discovered in multiple experiments since I was a child, when I had decided to bury a dead bird that I had found in with the tomato seeds without telling my mother. Those were some of the best tomatoes we'd ever grown, and one of the things I always loved being praised for. I hope Sasha would be happy. I think, as I carefully fold the mix of compost, raccoon flesh, and what looks to be part of Sasha's ear into the dirt around the first tomato plant. She always loved these tomatoes. Repeating over and over how she'd die to know how mine get to taste him this good. Not only should she likely know, now she'll be a part of the process. I hope this next crop grows out soon enough. I can't wait to have everyone try one and see how this crop tastes.